Philips Lighting. Within a group where we develop all kinds of nice stuff, mostly targeted on cloud environments. I have a background as being a software engineer, but the last 2 years more or less rolled into the whole DevOps stuff, infrastructure, etc. So something a bit about me. I stated. Actually, I'm a software engineer, so I like to program still in Java, Groovy, recently also some Scala, but also other obscure languages. My role within the organization where I'm currently working is chef leuke dingen doen. For the guys that are not native speakers in Dutch, that means that we have a freedom to play around. That's nice. So we take a lot of languages, platforms, frameworks, and we see what we can do with that. And some things get killed very quickly, and some things grow into products, that kind of stuff. That's a nice, when it goes back to a product, that's also the nicer thing. I'm also a wannabe chef. My kids tend to disagree. I'm a Netflix addict, all kind of cooking programs, and I always like to repeat that, but somehow the children cannot appreciate what I do. But that's still what I like. So what will be the agenda for this talk? It's about logging. For me, it's one of the most underestimated aspects in the application or in the platform whatsoever. People mostly tend to think, okay, yeah, logging is just log.info and that's it. But when you are in the operational space, let's say you have to monitor a bunch of systems or microservices or whatsoever, then logging at a certain moment becomes very important. So I want to tell you a bit about logging, certainly also about distributed logging, and I will do some demos using Fluentd, but that's indeed one of the tooling stuff that we use. We use Fluentd to collect all our logging and have a uniform logging layer in our infrastructures. Give you a small idea. The code is checked in on GitHub, so you can play around. It's for people who have Docker on their systems, check out the project and you can do the same stuff as I will be doing during this talk. So something on logging. Logging normally has a couple of steps. If you look at logging, it's not the log.info, log.debug or whatsoever. No, you generate log information, hopefully useful information. By the way, that's not always the case. We'll show you a little lines of code that we encountered in our systems. You need to collect it at a certain moment, you need to transport it to somewhere, you need to store it. Where do I leave my log data? Do I store it in Elasticsearch, or do I do it in a big file, or whatsoever? You need to analyze it. Certainly there are people, for example in our group we have test engineers, that look at certain failure cases and they want to analyze the logging information. And hopefully you will also be like to be alerted on some kind of triggers that happen inside your system. So providing useful information seems hard. A few sentences on that later on. But when you provide logging information, and not everybody is aware of that not every application that you are developing produces the same log format. And not everybody is aware that that's important. From a developer perspective, again, it's just the log.info and some text appears on screen, that's it. But once you have a complex system, where you have, for example, Scala applications, you have Groovy and Grails-based applications, you have Nginx applications, you want to pull in all kinds of data coming from HTTP web servers or whatsoever, then at a certain moment, the agreements on what kind of log format you're going to use become important. Certainly when you want to parse them at a later stage. If you have, let's say, in our case we have 50 microservices running, if you would have 50 different log formats, I would totally get crazy in how I would parse them or whatsoever. So there are a couple of them. You can find them on the internet. They are nicely documented. The common log format and the combined log format, for example, for web servers. The difference between the combined log format and the common log format is in the combined format, certainly for Apache, you get the client browser ID, for example. So if you want to have logging where you're interested in, okay, what kind of browser is my client using, then you should use the common combined log format. And you need to agree upon those log formats. So certainly within distributed teams or within a team, please choose a log format. And do not log related passwords. So if you generate stuff, do not say, okay, I'm logging in with this user with this password, etc. So garbage in really means garbage out. So these are some serious log messages that we encounter. I highlighted the nicer ones. That is something stuff that we really saw. Mostly, how did we end up here? That the developer has no clue how we got there, but just put a log message in it and we will know. Also, the getting tired of this log message is a developer has no clue on how to solve it. Just put a log message in it and etc. So you encounter a lot of stuff when you are at the end of the cycle. So your developer, fine, but if you're at the end and you have a couple of services and you need to analyze those log information, then you encounter this stuff. So you have some log considerations that you can take into account. And every company, every team can make some decisions on this. For example, the log levels that you use. Do we use fatal or not? Do we use warning? Do we use info? Do we use trace? And again, I think it's very valuable that within a team, or certainly within distributed teams, that you agree on, okay, we have a log format or a log level. What is the goal for this log level? For example, trace. Why do we use trace, etc. And again, the more you log, the less you can find. We encountered a situation where we got 19 million log records in an hour. And then our testers complained, we cannot find stuff. Yeah. Logging everything makes no sense. So you have your log information, and at a certain moment you need to collect that log information. At least you need to ship it somewhere. Or you have a bunch of applications and you need to collect it. You can do that using syslog, for example. You can write down log files in different places. That's always the nice one. You /var/log and you find a bunch of log files over there coming from HTTP, Docker log, whatsoever. So make sense of that. And certainly in Docker-based environments, those log files don't make any sense anymore. When you run a Docker container, logging to a log file has no sense. It stays in that container, or you mount a volume on the host. But still, so in container-based environments, logging to STD out, at least, has my preference. Then you still need a way to catch it. So you have your log information, you store it somewhere, and then you need to transport it somewhere. So you need to pick it up and do something with it. There are specialized transporters and collectors over there, which you can use, for example, Flume. In this case, FluentD, which I will be showing you, which are responsible for taking the data and transforming it and putting it somewhere else. And the nice thing about that is that you have a distributed system that you have multiple services, containers, databases, whatsoever. You can aggregate stuff in a very easy and simple way. And at the end, you still have to make sense of it. Do you need to pull the log data or going to push the log data? The STD out, for example, that's clear. You send something to STD out and somebody needs to catch it. But if you write to a log file, then somebody should pull it. Then you have the log data, you need to store it somewhere and you have different considerations to make, for example, cost-wise. And the statement that you have 90 million or 60 million log messages in an hour. We try to generate several gigabytes in an hour. You need to store them somewhere. And there are several considerations you can make over there. So of course, cost, but also retrieval speed. If you have a test department or you want to see your own logging, it's always nice that you can retrieve that log information on a fairly quick basis. So put a query, look for the information that you find, and it's fairly easy accessible. But also the ingestion speed is important. If you generate log information, then at a certain moment it becomes important how fast your logging framework is and how fast you can use that log data. We tend to use indeed, in this case, S3 as log storage. Elasticsearch, for example, is something where we put our information to. You can make your own choice. Then you have your log information and you need to analyze it. So you can do it in several ways. You can do command line stuff, but people tend to prefer a UI to get a view on the log data. A good example in this case is Kibana, which you can hook up to Elasticsearch. So you have your log information, you transport that to Elasticsearch, does some magic with it, so you can have free text searches on it. Anyone using Elasticsearch? Yeah? Fine. So don't have to tell anything about that. But then you can give your developers or your testers a nice UI where they can drill down on their log data, make their own queries, make their own visualizations, etc. And at a certain moment, you need to alert on data that you get, that you ingest. You see some correlations or whatsoever. My expertise is that Kibana, for example, is not the best solution for this. Is that there is a real difference between logging, your logging information, and monitoring system. Logging information is just seeing, okay, I diagnose stuff, so information is flowing from one system to the other, from one service to the other, what actually is my system doing. And monitoring, so alerting on specific events, something totally different. For example, you want to trigger on high JVM usage or processor usage or memory usage, that kind of stuff. That's often stuff where you want to be alerted upon. So logging is, don't mix and match logging and monitoring. So again, in a containerized world, we have to look at different at logging. Parse the data at the source. So you have something that runs your Docker containers, for example, that runs in the cloud. Collect that data as soon as possible and shift it somewhere else. Don't make it the burden, let's say, of a big backend system to parse all the log data, but do it as at the source. Talking about distributed logging, this is what we did until a couple of years ago. We developed our applications, and I was one of the guys who was doing that. We created an application, and that application that created some log data to some log file, and then you grab to the log file, see, okay, what is this application actually doing? Using all kinds of command line tooling to see, okay, I see some strange things or whatsoever. And you do manual operations on those log files. In a distributed environment where you have different services, databases, but can also have different services inside your application portfolio, that just does not work anymore. Data comes from different sources, has correlations between one and the other. So collecting all that data into a single stream and do a grab on it does not make any sense anymore. So this would be the situation if you would have that. So if you have your distributed application in the classical way, I say, okay, I'm still going to retrieve all the log data from the different systems. You have your log files which you parse, you rsync them from one place to the other. You do Hadoop jobs on MapReduce to get some information. And at a certain moment, this becomes one big spaghetti. If you ever have encountered a system like this, again, being a single developer on a single system is not a problem. But running something in production that has multiple services, this becomes a real nightmare. So we need something else. This is what the industry tends to call a unified logging layer, and it's not a it's not a product, it's more an approach how you deal with logging. At a certain moment you have your services, your applications that produce the logging, and you have your log collectors, which again parse data quickly, do that for example on the host. So you have a cluster with multiple servers, preferably you have a log collector on that server running. Collects the data from all the services running on that cluster and then ships it to somewhere else. And that's something which we call the log aggregator. So parsing we tend to do on the log collector, enrich the data, et cetera, and we send that off to the log aggregator. And that can send it to Elasticsearch, to whatever system you can define. And this is actually the same sweet spot for Fluentd. Logstash more or less is the same. They have the same sweet spot. They all talk about log collectors, log aggregators. Small stuff, a small intro on Fluentd, what you can do with it. I'll give you an insight. This is an implementation of that unified logging layer. So you have a small piece of software that is capable of parsing your or catching from different sources. In this case, for example, from Apache, which is stated over here, system log from databases, and actually have a, let's say, a runtime environment where all the log data comes in and is shipped to external systems, to MongoDB or MySQL or whatsoever. So what is it? It's an open source project. You can find it on the internet and download it. It's written in Ruby. People tend to say, okay, it's not the most fast language, but the fast stuff that they need in Fluentd, those are written in C. But you can download it, install it, and it's the nice thing about Fluentd, in my personal observations, is that it's very easy to use compared to other logging frameworks. So it's written in Ruby, reliable, at least that's what they state, and it's also what we can prove. At the end, we will have a demo on a high availability environment. If you have multiple collectors, multiple aggregators, you can kick out aggregators or collectors, and at a certain moment, stuff will keep running. It has a nice pluggable architecture, which I will show you a bit later on, where you can have a bunch of plugins, input, output plugins, transformers, etc. for your data. And we'll be doing some demos with that also. So this is a small example how does that work. In this case, we have a web server that's putting out access logs, normal access logs. We have Fluentd in the middle. So forget a bit about the log aggregator, log collector. This is the combined stuff for demo purposes. So you have your Fluentd, and your web server actually sends this logging information to an output. And in this case, the output could be an HTTP output that your Apache web server just does a post to Fluentd, whatever, or does a file tail. A file tail means that HTTP logs to a file, and using Fluentd, you can read in that file if you want. It can also be a forward, so web logs from Apache are sent to S3Out, and Fluentd catches that information and processes it. So that information comes in Fluentd, and then the magic happens. You have all kinds of event buffering processes, and you have all kinds of data transformation stuff that you can do. So the data is collected, transformed in the way that you want it, and at the end is inserted in Elasticsearch. So, one step back. So if you have the normal data that, for example, the web server sends out, Fluentd does something with it. It makes events from it. And how do those events look like? So you have your data. Data is received, and that data is always combined with a tag. A tag means actually an element that indicates what the source of that data is. And you can do all kinds of interesting stuff with that tag. Could be http.webserver whatsoever. And based on that tag, you can do all kinds of filters and matches, which we show later on. Where you can transform the data based on those tags. Or it always has a time, so if you don't provide a time, you can provide your own timestamps, but if you don't have timestamps, for example, Fluentd will add timestamps to the log information. And it has a record. And the record actually is just a plain dump log message that was received from, again, Apache, Spring Boot, or whatsoever. The whole tag, time and log data are structured in a JSON format. Internally, they use message pack for performance optimizations. But if you see it on screen, for example, in the log output, you see a nice JSON representation of that data. So this is an event. Web server sends a access log to Fluentd, to my log environment, and Fluentd makes something out of this. Now you could wonder, okay, where does this tag come from? I will show you later on where this tag comes from. That's from a configuration element, for example, in your Docker logging driver or other configurations. For the sake of the demo, we will use a tag that is being configured on the log driver. So what you see in the record, this piece of text, so this log format, is actually parsed inside elements. So in this case, for example, there's no user field, so that's blank. But a method is, for example, is available. So you can extract elements from your log message into specific attributes. And those attributes, again, can be used, for example, for ingestion in Elasticsearch. So you can see, okay, I want to count on all my get methods, or I want to do a count on all my 404s or whatsoever. Now, the pluggable architecture, in the core, there's the engine itself, a small piece of software, which you can download. During the demo, we will be using a Docker container. That's also something which they provide. Download the Docker container, and you can play around with it. And the only thing you have to do is combine it with plugins. Input plugins, output plugins, and buffer plugins. Input plugins is, okay, what is the kind of information that Fluentd can accept? Is that information coming from STD out? In this case, that will be the forward plugin. Or is it coming from an HTTP endpoint, so that an external application will send something to Fluentd, then you have an HTTP endpoint? Or, for example, again, tail. And with tail, you point to a log file, and that log file is read. All kinds of buffer stuff. Why would you need that? Internally, Fluentd processes the log data, and at a certain time interval, and you can configure those time intervals, the buffers are filled, and after the time interval, the buffers are flushed. So you can set that the time interval very low, for example, that data is sent in to Fluentd, something is done, and after 5 seconds, everything is sent out. But it has some implementations or implications on the CPU usage. So the recommendation is not to set the timing elements too quick, so that Fluentd has the option to do something with it. And the output plugins, yeah, where do you want to go with the data? Should it go to a file? Should it go to Elasticsearch? Whatsoever. So you have your Fluentd stuff, you download it. You download your Docker container from Docker Hub, then you need to do something with it. You have an empty one, does not contain any elements, does not contain any plugins, but you need to configure it. That's all driven by a simple, basic configuration file. It has a few elements, like the source, what is the data, where it's coming from, matchers, filters, and labels. Now, source, again, what is the input? Matchers, that tells Fluentd what to do with that data, based, for example, on a tag. I will show you later on pieces where it will become a bit more clear. And filters. So if you want to enrich data with stuff that you need to retrieve or whatsoever, you can have a whole filter chain throughout the life cycle of a log message. You can strip out data, add data, etc. And at a certain moment, you can also combine those filters and matches in logical groupings, and there's something where you use labels for. So data comes in, goes to filters, another filter, possible another filter, and at the end, it ends up in an output element. The configuration is a bit based on XML. It's not XML, but it uses the tags. So this is a basic configuration that tells Fluentd on receiving events using HTTP. So you have a fluentd.config file, and you have this block inside it, nothing more. You start up Fluentd, pointing to that config file, and at that moment you have an endpoint available where you can do HTTP posts to. So on this case, port 9880, send data, and Fluentd can do something with it. So data coming in. Another thing, another example is the tail stuff. And this instructs Fluentd to look at that file, and if something has been added to that file, get it from that file and process it. So that's the tail stuff. And here you see an example of the tag element. In this case, also a tag is added to an event. So you read a log file, Fluentd reads that log file, does something with the data, and adds a tag to that event. And those tags are used for the filtering process. Filtering and matches, filter will come in a moment. So here we have a match on alert, but this could also be a match on apache.access, for example. So if we have a tag coming in, or an event coming in inside Fluentd, that has a specific tag. In this case, starts with alert, and you can have all kinds of wildcards with dollars, etc. So it's some kind of a regular expression. This will be matched and instructs Fluentd to do something with this data. In this case, every event which has a tag alert, starting with alert, will be written to a specific file. So coming back to the Apache stuff, so if you have a source that reads in HTTP data coming from a file, that data is enriched with a tag, and in a matcher you can say, okay, store this data in MongoDB. So you have the event flow to it. You can also do other things. This is something which is used in high availability setups. Data is coming in, and you have a forward tag, so you have one Fluentd instance. This is more or less the collector versus the aggregator stuff. So you have an instance of Fluentd that collects the data. Data is coming in. And at a certain moment, you say, okay, I match everything because I'm not doing anything in my collector with it. And I will try to offer the data which I have processed to another instance of Fluentd which is running somewhere. And this is the HA setup. So you have two servers in this case. So all data will be going in and will be sent to one of the two servers. If one of the two servers dies, the other one takes over. There's also a wait option. You can say more or less load balancing stuff. So you have a lot of data that needs to be processed. You have a couple of log aggregators, for example. You can set a wait on it. So if you, let's say, that's an element, as stated here, 20% goes to the first one and 60% goes to the other one. So it's just a ratio. If you don't do that, they all have the same weight, and on your aggregator nodes, you see just data popping by. So if you want to add stuff to an event, for example, on the collector node, what the host name was of that collector node, you can do stuff like this. So you get data, add stuff using the record transformer. If you look at the Fluentd website, they have a whole list of that stuff, where you can say, okay, record transformer, delete elements or whatsoever. This is just a small example. And this is the label stuff I mentioned. So if you're done with processing, then at a certain moment you want to shift it to a sub-area of your logging policies. Then you can attach a label to it, so now I'm done. And then you have a logical grouping of filters, matchers, somewhere in your configuration files. The use case for this is maybe not clear, but in our case, for example, we use this very heavily to catch stack traces in, for example, Spring Boot stuff. Docker has a tendency, if there's a stack trace, to send out every line in that stack trace as being a single log rule. The effect of that is that inside the backing infrastructure of your logging software, where your testers are analyzing stuff, they see 20, 30 separate messages, and they have to correlate them together. So it's not tied together. So we use a concatenation plugin that's also available, where we say, okay, we have an event coming in with a specific log format, and we wait until the next element comes by. If the next log statement comes by and we don't have a match, then we concatenate the stuff, we buffer the stuff, and we send it to a specific label. So let's do some demos. Enough talking. So this is something that we will do. A small demo setup. We will start with just simple running Fluentd, bare bones, naked. Then you have a clue on how the configuration file looks like, how we can build it up. And I hope to convince you that it's very easy to implement it. And that's one of the biggest attractions, at least for us, to adopt Fluentd as our unified logging layer. So it will be split into two elements, the collection and transporting stuff, and the storing and analysis element, where we hook up Kibana to Elasticsearch, etc. So what's needed to run Fluentd? In this case, we will be using Docker. You can download it and the software, of course, but I tend to use Docker, certainly for demo purposes. But feel free to download Fluentd yourself and do your own stuff. They provide a nice Docker image which you can extend, add your own plugins, and build your own custom containers for it. In this case, I've built a Fluentd demo Docker container, and I will show you a bit on how that is being configured. This container is started, it mounts a local volume on my system, so I have different steps, 1 to 6 or 7 or whatsoever, and every step has a different configuration file, so I can just use the same image with a different configuration file and see, okay, how does it operate. And I expose a port. I will start with the monitoring agent. It's nothing fancy, but this is something that we use to see, okay, is Fluentd actually doing something? Is it up, yes or no? No, let me check. All right, let me first show you the configuration of the demo image. Oh. CD Docker image, CD Fluentd demo, CD more Docker file. So this is our custom setup of our Fluentd image. It installs a couple of plugins. Again, the plugins are also built on Ruby. We install the Elasticsearch plugin. At the end, we will send some demo to some data to Elasticsearch. We will send some data to MongoDB at the end. Grokparser, something I will come back later on. This is it, nothing more. So we have the basic image, and that's it. So let's go to my steps. So what I have over here is my Docker Compose file, as stated earlier on. Just taking my image and running it, and mounting the local volume. And the local volume actually points to the fluentd.conf. And this is actually all what's in there for the fluentd.com. So we start with this simple thingy. I use Docker Compose. I use a shortcut. I got fed up of Docker Compose, just too much. So DC is Docker Compose in my case. It's starting. You see some output. So it also shows you exactly how the configuration is built. So if you're building a configuration for your unified logging layer, something is not correct, it will give you that information. So, this is cheating, of course. Yeah, nothing more. It just, this is calling the endpoint. There's an endpoint, API plugins .json, so it does not have an health endpoint. This is the endpoint for the monitoring stuff, and gives you an indication what is loaded currently. Right. DC down. So, break it up. We have the monitoring agent. Now we want to get some data coming from a Docker container as being the first step in this small demo setup. So we have our Fluentd, so we are going to extend this Docker Compose file a bit. We have still the same Fluentd image with the same plugins, etc., with a slightly changed configuration in it. I have a small Echo container which I use, which just sends out some information to stdout in this case. This does some bash stuff, just does a log message. And I have a logging driver enabled for this Docker container. So this is the trigger to tell Docker to send the information to Fluentd. If you don't do this, then it will end up nowhere, or it will end up in a JSON file and you will see nothing. So don't forget to use the correct log driver if you want to play with Fluentd in this case. So the Fluentd address is running on my local host. Yeah.
If I use the Fluentd logging driver, can I still look into the Docker
log? No. That's not something which is the cause of Fluentd, but the cause of Docker. So if you configure a logging driver, that's it. And we had the same question. I want to see data, but I also want to see it in JSON format, for example. You cannot combine currently different log. Okay, now that's something. Yeah. Okay, thanks. So we add this log driver to it. We add an input plugin. So in this case, it will listen on a specific IP port. It will bind to all IP addresses, and all information which is sent from a logging container to this IP address will be cached by Fluentd. Let's get to another step, CD step see. So let's show the fluentd.conf. This is not. Where is it? Let me make it a bit bigger. Just to give you an idea, I have a Docker container that generates some dummy data, but there is also a dummy plugin, type dummy, which does the generation for you. But I do not use it, I use that stuff, but it's something you can use. And in this case, I have the source element, so look on a specific IP, and I dump the information which I get from remote systems to my STD out. So everything which is sent to my Fluentd container will be sent out to Fluentd STD out. Now you see the. It's a bit tricky now to see, but I have one Docker container. Let me show you Docker PS. I have one Docker container in this case, which is sending data to STD out using the logging driver. Oh. Where am I? Over there. And Fluentd is actually now processing the message. So what you see over here, I will terminate the stuff a bit. Here is the elements that Fluentd actually exposes. So you have the in this case the tag, and you have all kinds of information that are added default by Fluentd. So you have the container ID, that kind of stuff, which are automatically added to Fluentd. Still not something you can do anything with, but it gives you an indication how the stuff works. Now we're going to do something else. We're going to hook up Apache. So I've configured Apache HTTP daemon to send out data in the combined log format, so the using the user agent. So I can, when I navigate to Apache, I can, with Chrome or whatsoever, the user agent is also captured. When you run HTTP normally, so you pull a Docker container, you don't have that agent element. It uses the common log format, but it has just very basic information. You get the idea now. I'm just extending my Docker file, so I will not be doing this again and again. You get the idea. I will just be extending it using the same log driver. So I'll add HTTP as a Docker container, add a log driver, etc. So this is the last time I'm going to show you anything about this. But it runs this HTTP server on port 80. Again, use the Fluentd driver, etc. This is the Fluent configuration file. Again, I have the Fluentd running, listening on this specific port. And it filters on a specific tag. So I'm going to get one step back. On the bottom, you see that tag. Configuration of your Docker container. Every log message which will be sent out using STDOut will be prefixed with that tag. In the configuration file of Fluentd, I can do all kinds of nice stuff with that tag. Can filter, etc. And in this case, I do a filter on that HTTP.access log. I parse it, and that means that I will take out the elements that I'm interested in. And for sake of simplicity, I remove the regular expression pattern. We'll come back to better solutions for that, for the regular expression, later on. But you can type in regular expressions that actually gets the data from that log message. It's important to note that there's a specific order. If I would, for example, put that match above the filter HTTP.access, then it will never reach my filter element. So it bit me a few times ago that I, why doesn't it work? And then, okay, I've made a fault in the order of configuring Fluentd. So if you do a match and you catch all, then that catches it and filters are not kicked in anymore. Right? Oh, damn. Let's go to 3. So I will do, did I do this stop? DC down, just to be sure. DC up. Now, this gives some information. Don't be scared about this. So now, if it's okay, I have an endpoint somewhere. HTTP server. It works, it states. And this is the input which you get. So still very cryptical, at least from logging perspective. But here are the elements that FluentD has parsed. So it has parsed, in this case, the agent. So you see key value pairs in this. You see the host. You see still no user in it. I'm not logged in. But it extracts the information from the log file. You see. And to give you an idea how that regular expression looks like, let's move FluentD. It will just not fit on my screen. But this is the regular expression that is needed to parse that stuff. I'm not a regular expression guru, so I need to look up and test and whatsoever. Took me some time to construct this. And luckily, some other people have done the hard work for me. So if you look fairly well, you can have the correct formats over there. Right. Now we will do something else. We catch the information, we process it, and we send it to MongoDB in this case. So I'm not going to show you the Docker Compose file. Believe me, there's a Mongo database inside it that's ready to catch the data. And now we use something else. Use the copy plugin. It's default, you don't have to install anything for it. But what the copy plugin actually means, data comes in, so you match. Data comes in, and you can direct it to different destinations. So in this case, I do a copy to STDOut, so I can visualize it, and I do a copy to Mongo. In this case, I will have a MongoDB database running on my host system in a Docker container. The data will be put into a collection called test, and hopefully data arrives over there. Damn, I have to get used to not doing that. DC down to be sure. CD. DC. So now Mongo is starting. Let me Docker PS, Docker exec, NZT, MongoDB, bash. Again, never do this, but for demo purposes, I'm actually entering the Mongo database now. And I always have. I need to call the shell, Mongo, show DBs. And currently there's still nothing in my Mongo system whatsoever. There's no data which has been processed to go to this container. So let's generate some load. I have a generate load script over here. Oh, and what this generate load script does, it does post something to an endpoint. I will be seeing some data, hopefully. Oh, where is it? Over there. So it will just generate some load with a dummy user agent between 0 to 10. And data is now arriving. Again, copying to STD out. And I hope that I have a show DBs, a FluentD. In this case, I have a FluentD database. FluentD. Use FluentD. User, you're right. So, and I always have problems. I'm not an expert in Mongo. Or in, yeah. So I actually queried now Mongo on the amount of records which are in there. And did I already stop? Or is this the. Yeah. So there you see the flush. Eh? So we have a flush for 5 seconds. After 5 seconds, FluentD flushes stuff out to whatever endpoint you have. So I'll quit this one. Don't quit too much, I hope. Exit. Sorry? It will automatically retry. Yeah. And that's the purpose of the buffer plugin. So in the copy, you have an internal buffer. If it cannot forward it, and there's always a backup element, which I'm not showing, but there's an element in your site configuration file. If everything fails, dump it somewhere to S3 or to a file or whatsoever. Yeah. DC down. All right. Yeah. Now we will introduce Elasticsearch and this whole stuff. So again, we're just simple extending the configuration file. Store, I removed, by the way, the Mongo stuff, that's not in, but I have an Elasticsearch container which is running on my system where the data will be sent to. And it will also be sent to file in this case. DC. Yeah. So again, Fluentd starting, Elasticsearch is starting. To visualize stuff, also Kibana is in the Docker Compose file. Otherwise, yeah, I don't know the commands by head to query Elasticsearch, so I use Kibana for that. Where was it? Five. Still, I need to generate some load again. Oh. It's the same script. No. Go to Elasticsearch. Kibana, and hopefully it needs some time to go from red state to yellow to green, so this is done now. I've configured Fluentd just to send the data in a logstash format, so Kibana was empty, promise me, or believe me. I create an index, and in this case you see all the elements that I have exposed in the regular expression. Those elements are also now available in Kibana. So you can search for log data. Oh, let me do it a bit smaller. You can look for all kinds of stuff. And you can also visualize stuff very quickly. So if, for example, if you would make a pie chart and you're interested in a certain user agent, okay, this one, we split size on a term. I do it by field agent keyword, and then so the size is 10. So I generate user agents in that script from 1 to 10. So you can see that you can use Kibana in this way to visualize the data in Elasticsearch. All right, let's shut that down. Stop my load stuff. See down. For time's sake, I have 2 minutes. I will not show you the Spring Boot stuff, but Spring Boot stuff is just another log format, so another parser. I will not show you the demo, but I will show you an alternative for the regular expressions. Because regular expressions, at least I find them horrible. That's why I use the Grok parser. And Grok parser is actually a format which also logstash uses, where you have elements. And runtime, those elements are replaced in regular expressions. So in this case, data comes in, I match on a specific tag, in this case Spring Boot. Data is parsed, and I use a Grok parser in this. And this is where the magic happens. So in the timestamp, ISO, whatsoever, Grok has a lot of different elements, where you can define a string like this, and then it's much more pleasant to work with log rules instead of the regular expressions. So that's where the Grok plugin comes in place. Quickly do the HA setup, I have 1 minute. So this is the setup. I cannot run multiple collector nodes, but I have two aggregator nodes, node 1 and node 2. Depending on what I see in the log file, I will kick out one of the two, and hopefully the other one kicks in. I will do that. CD 7. In this case, I have two different configurations. CD collector, more fluentd.conf. And this is my collector that just does something. And the interesting part is on the matcher. So here I have a primary and a secondary host. If one of the hosts fail, the collector automatically targets one aggregator to the other. You see up. So collector is starting, and two aggregators are starting. I will show the Docker PS for this. So I have two aggregators, one collector. I will generate some load. This will be a digit between 1 to 200. So let me quickly prepare the stuff. Docker ps, docker stop, fluentd aggregator 1. So in a moment I will stop this one. Generate load. You see data coming in. So data arrives at the collector, arrives now at aggregator 1. And hopefully aggregator 2 also will kick in. Aggregator. So this is the load balancing stuff that you now see. Stop. And aggregator 2 is still busy. Did I do this typing? Yeah, exited. And now every data which is sent is automatically targeted to the other aggregator. So once the other aggregator starts up again, it will be joining the cluster again, and the collector will distribute the load evenly. That's it for me. I see a big red zero appearing. Any questions? Sorry? Yeah, I will post the slides and also this whole Docker stuff. And what's I have also a guide where you can do your own stuff, which more or less displays runs the scenario which I've just done. So you can play around with your own trials. Docker images will also be published. So after the conference, I will send out everything. Yeah? Any more questions?
In your case, what was the reason to prefer
Fluentd
over Logstash?
In our case, Logstash was far too complex. Yeah, so we started with Logstash and we had so many problems, not because we're not intelligent enough, but we were looking for a way to do stuff quickly. And the use case was for us, okay, if we can do this in such small steps, so build it up quickly without the whole complicated Logstash configuration, it worked for us nicely. Yeah. Yeah? Thanks very much.